Good morning.
Good morning. This is Wazo X Wazo. I was thinking that maybe this channel has been doing an overabundance of interviews lately, though the interviews have been exciting. Pablo Bartholomew and Alexander Gorlitsky and Annapurna Garamella, all those people I've been interviewing lately. But thought maybe I should get back just for a while to a few rants. Actually, this isn't a rant. Actually, I just want to like say a few things, especially to younger artists. And so, once again, it's time for... So there's some really, really good videos other than my own on YouTube I would recommend for you all young artists to listen to. And one is a video by Jerry Saltz, and he's talking in Chicago.
I want the students in their, out loud, you should do something like that. Yes, Mr. Saltz, it used to be very cool. Your rents were cheap. Rats crawled over your bed. So you act very nice on the outside. But on the inside, you do this. You take your samurai sword, and you go, wah, 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 wah. They're not helping you. It's always hard to make art. It was hard for the first people. It's hard for you. It was so hard for me that I stopped making art in this beautiful city. At 3:15, when the demons speak to you, what do? You're no good. You don't have any original ideas. You're faking it. So are you. You're not very rich, you don't have any time. You got a crapola apartment. You work 40 hours a week. You stink. You don't know how to draw. You didn't even go to the right school. What do? What do you do? That's what I'm going to talk to you a little bit about. And I stopped making art. I want to give you an example of somebody who gave in to the demons, and it hurts. I want to tell you something. Every day I miss making art. Every day it hurts.
Wonderful talk. It's about an hour long. No, not that much. 45 minutes worth for anyone to listen to, especially if you're a younger artist coming up. Really makes you think about the art world and the struggles. Jerry Saltz is the art critic at, I think, the New York Times. I always confuse him and his wife, who's reviewing for Ware. But well worth a listen. Find the link in this, the description to this video, and go to that and listen to it. I think one of the things that I see right now in the pedagogy of young artists is they're really being asked to constrict to a certain type and form. And I'm not talking about style. I'm not talking about medium necessarily. But certainly I see that young artists are often encouraged to not really do what they're good at. They're encouraged, well, you're really good at drawing, so why don't you try to go and make an installation? You understand what I'm saying. You're really good at sculpture. It's so realistic. Well, why don't you just smash that all to pieces and try to do something that's more expressive? You know, it doesn't have to be so realistic. Hey, if you got the talent to do something, if you got the talent to draw in a beautiful, realistic manner, if you got the talent to sculpt in a realistic manner, use that talent, because not everybody has it. Whole lot of artists these days don't have those basic skills anymore, including myself. That's why I have to rely on my collaborators. If you've got that talent, use it. That doesn't mean you have to make traditional art in a traditional way that's boring and humdrum. No, but you can perfect those skills and you can transfer them and use them in something that's more exciting, you know, more innovative, and that's for you to come up to know what are you going to do that's more creative with those skill levels that has not already been done. But whatever you do, don't abandon the skills. Don't abandon the skills just to be cool and think, oh, well, I would rather do sound installation because I think sound installation is the thing that's more cool and it'll get me into the workshop Biennale circuit. You know, it's just, it's ridiculous. Don't do that. Don't smoke. Don't smoke beedies. That's another thing. Just don't smoke beedies or anything, really. Little ganja doesn't hurt once in a while. We all know that helps us think a little as artists or musicians. There's another clip, and I know a lot of people don't like Jordan Peterson because he's been so trashed as being sort of a right-wing conservative. But Jordan says a lot of really cool stuff, and once in a while, there are things he says that are really, really good for artists to listen to. This is one of them.
This is the Peter Pan story, roughly speaking. Is Peter Pan is this magical boy. Pan is the god of everything, roughly speaking, right? And so it's not an accident that he has the name Pan. And he's the boy that won't grow up. And he's magical. Well, that's because children are magical. They can be anything. They're nothing but potential. And Peter Pan doesn't want to give that up. Why? Well, he's got some adults around him, but the main adult is Captain Hook. Well, who the hell wants to grow up to be Captain Hook? First of all, you've got a hook. Second, you're a tyrant. And third, you're chased by the dragon of chaos with a clock in its stomach, right? The crocodile, it's already got a piece of you. Well, that's what happens when you get older. Time has already got a piece of you. And eventually, it's got a taste for you. And eventually, it's going to eat you. And so Hook is so traumatized by that that he can't help but be a tyrant. And then Peter Pan looks at traumatized Hook and says, well, no, I'm not sacrificing my childhood for that. So that's fine, except he ends up king of the Lost Boys. In Neverland, well, Neverland doesn't exist, and who the hell wants to be king of the Lost Boys? And he also sacrifices the possibility that he'll have a real relationship with a woman, because that's Wendy, right? And she's kind of conservative, middle-class, London-dwelling girl. She wants to grow up and have kids and have a life. She accepts her mortality, she accepts her maturity. Peter Pan has to content himself with Tinkerbell. She doesn't even exist. She's like the fairy of porn. She doesn't exist. She's the substitute for the real thing. And so, but the dichotomy that you're talking about, it's very tricky, because there's a sacrificial element in maturation, right? You have to sacrifice the pluripotentiality of childhood for the actuality of a frame. And the question is, well, why would you do that? Well, one reason is, it happens to you whether you do it or not. You can either choose your damn limitation, or you can let it take you unaware when you're 30, or even worse, when you're 40. And then that is not a happy day. And you see, I see people like this, and I think it's more and more common in our culture, because people can put off maturity without suffering an immediate penalty. But all that happens is the penalty accrues, and then when it finally hits, it just wallops you. Because when you're 25, you can be an idiot. It's no problem. Even when you're out in a job search, it's like, well, you don't have any experience and you're kind of clueless. It's, yeah, you're young, you know, it's no problem. We can, that's what young people are like, but they're full of potential. Okay, well, now you're the same person at 30. It's like, people aren't so thrilled about you at that point. It's like, what the hell have you been doing for the last 10 years? Well, I'm just as clueless as I was when I was 22. It's, yeah, but you're not 22. You're an old infant, right? And that's an ugly thing, an old infant. So, part of the reason you choose your damn sacrifice, because the sacrifice is inevitable, but at least you get to choose it.
And this is another.
I'll talk to you a little bit today about what artists do and why, and then more specifically what canvases do, and perhaps why. I think, I'll tell you something we've discovered in my lab. I'm a professor in the psychology department at St. George, University of Toronto. Because it's culturally relevant. You know, there's a real tension in our culture between, say, the capitalist forces, so to speak, and people who are critics of capitalism. And most of the supporters of capitalism are sort of on the right wing end of things. And there are complicated reasons for that. A lot of them are personality based. But capitalism depends on entrepreneurs. And entrepreneurs are not like managers and administrators. And so managers and administrators, of course, are necessary to keep the entire capitalist edifice going, the whole social edifice going. But entrepreneurs are necessary to continually generate the new ideas that allow us to keep pace with the changing environment, with culture itself. And entrepreneurs are like artists. They have exactly the same personality structure. So the entrepreneurs are with the artists. And that's a real problem in some ways for our political culture, because the right wing, of course, promotes capitalistic social structures, but is not temperamentally inclined to appreciate art. And that means they're not temperamentally inclined to set things up to foster entrepreneurial activity, and that's really not a good thing. It also means that the people on the more conservative end of the political spectrum radically underestimate the utility of artistic endeavor, both practically and culturally, because artistic endeavor, in some sense, is at the base of everything people do.
Open your minds. Open your minds. I know these are hard times we're living through now, and they're going to get even harder. I follow the stock market, okay? The share market in the U.S. just crashed horribly. It crashed horribly in India, too. We're all basically screwed with the stock market right now. A lot of that has to do with coronavirus, which is spreading around the world, and everybody's getting under quarantine. And that affects the business climate, which affects the stock market. People can't travel. I've heard artist friends already telling me they were planning to go to Wuhan, China. This is serious. Go to Wuhan, China to go and study at the, I don't know what it's called, the University of Wuhan or something, and they've had to cancel or postpone. I've already heard of artists saying they're going to camps or whatever. They're thinking of postponing because maybe it's not a good time to Italy. one of my favorite countries. I love Italy. I love Italy just as much. Well, maybe not. Well, it's a hard decision for me between India and Italy, actually. There's so much. I mean, we're going through times that are highly political now, and I know it. I mean, the world has never been more polarized in my lifetime. And I'm 66 years old, going to be 67 in November. The world's really polarized now between the right and the left. And if you follow me on Facebook, you know, I'm kind of middle of on the road, middle of the road. I'm sounding like Joe Biden now with a little bit of senility, but I'm pretty middle of the road, actually. I tend to post on social media some more right-wing things because it seems like all my artist friends are left-wing, 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 left-wing. Hey, get out of that bubble. Start listening to what other people have to say. I know, shocking to hear me say that, isn't it? But you should. And, you know, if you lean kind of right-wing, you should get out of that bubble and listen to what the left-wing's having to say. And the main thing is, realize you're young, okay? You don't have a life experience yet. You have opinions, of course. We all have opinions when we're young, but you haven't gone through academia in a serious manner. You haven't started a business. You haven't had to pay serious taxes. You haven't had to work at a job in any meaningful way and advance your career. All of these things for me, maybe you don't own property, maybe you never will, but all of these things as you go through life will change your political opinions. Many people end up becoming more conservative. Some people end up becoming far more liberal. Some people become really leftist when initially they were rather right-wing. So it's like you change as you grow. Don't assume that what you think politically now is what you're going to think politically years from now. And one of the things I always think about the arts, people say I want to keep politics out of the arts. No, I don't. I don't. Politics can be in the arts. But don't forget the humanism. Don't forget the humanity. You know, the other day I did a piece on Sudipta Das, and I really like Sudipta's work. Sudipta Das's work is great. She just had the show at Latitude 28 in Delhi on immigration. And if you watch that video, and if you know me, you'll know I'm not an open borders person. I'm pretty sympathetic to the whole idea that nations have to be nations, nations have to have borders in order to survive, basically, in order to give you all the things you might want, the health care and all of that. Countries have to have some control over their own system. So I don't really agree with Sudipta in some ways, but the reason I like Sudipta Das is because she humanizes the issue. She humanizes the issue to a point that even somebody like me, who isn't necessarily in agreement, I can see through her eyes and see the plight of people and understand the human qualities of it. And to me, that's the function of an artist, you know, because everybody else in this world, everybody is running around with an agenda. They've got an agenda. They want to make more money. They want to buy a house. They want to buy a car. They want their political party to win. They want to kick out Modi. They want to keep Modi in office. I mean, who knows what the agenda might be, but what gets lost in all of that is the idea that we are all human beings. We all have families. We all have mothers, fathers, children. We all have to deal with the problems of educating our children, feeding ourselves, the hurt and pain of love. How much art talks about love these days? I mean, do artists ever think about talking about things like romance and love and hurt and pain, the difficulties of growing older? All of those things are human things, and I feel those are the things that in a polarized society like we have now all over the world, those are the things that bring us together, is that human element. So anyway, it's getting late in the day. I've probably said enough, and it's Holi. I'm doing this on Holi, believe it or not. So happy Holi. Hope you enjoyed this, and please remember to like and subscribe. See you next time. This is Wazwex Wazwo Evil O from Udaipur. Bye. Bye.
It dominates the universities because you can learn it in about a week. You sound like an intellectual to outsiders, and you don't have to do any work, any real thinking. Mm.